In your Bibles, underline power of darkness. Power of. Anytime I want to talk about the power you are about to receive tonight, the first kind of power that comes to my mind is this power. Power of darkness. From this statement, Jesus, usher, go and sit down, go and walk, no talking, no going around. Leave Reverend alone. You yourself, go and sit down and study the Word of God. From that single verse, Jesus has said three things about power of darkness. Please, my brother, read it again. And I want you to listen.
53. When I was daily with you in the temple,
yes,
you stretched forth no hands against me.
Uh-huh.
But this is your hour and the power of darkness.
There are three truths in that statement. But before I explain the truths, we thank God so much for the missionaries who brought Christianity to Africa. I was privileged to be with my discipler. What you people call mentor is what I call discipler. And that is the person of evangelist Billy Graham, that world-renowned Baptist evangelist. He happened to be my discipler even before I ever went to the seminary. I had the privilege of being with him, with some other people. Our reason for being together there was for world evangelization through itinerant evangelism. I was surprised when he told us that when their own parents came to Africa to preach the gospel, that their parents did their best. That man there, no going about. Tonight is your night of power. You have to be serious. You have to be serious. So I was surprised when he said, why is it that we want to be moving about tonight? Why? He said when their parents came to Africa, their parents did their best, referring to the missionaries. That their parents did their best, but that they have now discovered that the best of their parents was not good enough for Africans. I caught that statement. And he went on to explain the reason why. He said, when missionaries came to Africa, they didn't understand the language of the people. Help him, sit him down. Oh my God. Have you been to court to hear some cases before? Can anybody just be walking in the court premises? We are gathered in the presence of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. If there is one thing you must learn these 4 days, it is how to reverence God when you come to his house. I pastor churches for 16 and a half years before becoming an evangelist. I know church very well. But I think we should be disciplined. So he said, The white man never understood our language. He didn't know our culture. He said, so when he preached and he was sweating, and in the end he gave invitation to an African to accept Jesus, he said many of them will come forward, but they were only accepting Jesus on top of other gods. I agree with him. There are many people, many believers in our churches today who only accepted Jesus on top of other gods. Therefore, he concluded, he said, the reason we have brought you up here to train you is that you might go back to your people and preach the gospel, contextualize the gospel. Don't syncretize. Contextualize it. Preach the gospel in the language that they understand. Use illustration from their culture. He said, because in communication, if you don't understand the language of people, you don't understand their culture, you cannot communicate effectively. He said, what you have in Africa is polytheism, not monotheism. They believe in many gods. He said, so we have brought you here to train you so you can go back to your people and explain the gospel to them in the language they understand, because we have now come to the conclusion that only Africans can win Africans. I took up the challenge because I knew very well that was exactly what was happening in my home. We believe God, we believe Jesus, but we still have our cult. Why? It's not that we are not believers. It is simply that we find it difficult to put our trust in God alone. In the midst of many deities, the white man was not wrong, because he grew up in basically scientific environment. The white man can only believe what he sees. He can only trust what he tests in the laboratory. I never grew in scientific environment. I grew up in basically spiritual and demonic environment. I need power. The white man doesn't need power because he's not confronted with demonic powers. My own parents brought me up in the midst of demonic power and negative spiritualities. Thank God, Paul said in the book of Colossians, he said one reason we must thank Jesus is that he delivered us from the power of darkness. So if you see people who come to church, very religious, very active, and still believe in cult and charms, don't blame them. They are only behaving like the travelers to Emmaus, running for their dear lives. They believe God, they believe Jesus, but they can't trust him because they have not experienced the power that is given in exchange for the power that he grew inside of. Jesus said, I know your problem. You go back now. Where there is a promise. And that promise is the promise of power. You just go back to Jerusalem. Don't pray. Don't fast. Just wait there until you are endued with power from on high. That's the power you are about to receive tonight. Amen. But I show you that Jesus Christ said three things from the statement in Luke 22 verse 53. Number one, he said our parents were right. In what sense? Our parents believed that power of darkness was real. They brought us up with that belief. Jesus said our parents were right. Our papa and mama, correct. Power of darkness, day. That's the first thing Jesus Christ said. Listen to him again. He said, I've been with you in the temple daily. You never came against me, but I recognize what is happening now. This is your hour and the power of darkness. Jesus recognized the reality of the power of darkness. That's the first truth. Truth number two, he said, although power of darkness is real, but it is limited. How? Because he said, I've been with you daily. Why didn't the power of darkness work daily? Because it is limited. So if you are here listening to me tonight, and you still believe, you still trust, you still depend upon this power of darkness, I have bad news for you. Very, very bad news. You know the bad news? The bad news is, we are not arguing with you. Power of darkness is real, but it is limited. Meaning that soon and very soon, it will fail you. Put your hands together for Jesus. We are not blaming you. You have every right to protect your life, but it should not be through the power of darkness, because the power of darkness is limited. Number three, in that same verse, he said, I've been with you daily, you never came against me. Underline the word against in your Bible. That's why I love King James. You never came against me. What does that mean? That simply means that by nature. Now, let me ask you, what is the opposite of against? What Jesus was saying is that power of darkness is real, power of darkness is limited, and power of darkness is not for anybody. It can't work for. By nature, it works against. What does that mean? If it appears the power of darkness is working for you now, wait. When it finishes working on those people you use the power against, the power is going to return to you and work against you. So please, I beg you, repent. Change. Give your life to Jesus. He has provision for your protection. He has provision for your security. He has power for you to replace the ye power that he asked you to drop. I finished the first assignment. There's the second type of power. In John chapter 1, my brother, don't listen to me. Open your Bible. If you are the one to read, you listen a little, you focus on Bible a little. Eh? If not, I will sack you. Today na King's Day. So no joke. John chapter 1. Are you there? Read from verses 11 and 12. John chapter 1, 11 and 12.
1 verse 11.
You don't have to call it again.
He came unto his own.
Good.
And his own received him not. But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God.
God bless.
Even to them that believe on his name.
In that your Bible underline power again. What is the first type of power that Jesus Christ recognized? Huh?
Power of darkness.
Huh? Now you have underlined another power. What power is this?
Power of God.
I'm not going to talk much about this because those of you, please sit down, my brother. Those of you who are here yesterday should know something about this. This is the power that connects you to the family of God, that brings you into relationship with God. You are born outside. All of us were outcast. But when Jesus Christ died on the cross, because of what he did for you and for me, God gave us power to become children of God. This is the power that connects you into the family of God. The day you gave your life to Jesus Christ, this is how you entered into relationship with God. This is the kind of power that Baptists are proud of. This is the power they talk, they refer to when they say, once I'm saved forever. In my Sunday school teacher, in my Sunday school yesterday, my teacher, is he here today? My Sunday school teacher yesterday, he's not around. Are you? Let me see your hand. Where? Up? Oh, God bless you. He's a good teacher. He taught me yesterday. But there was a question. The question had to do with what Baptists always say, that once I'm saved forever. And I told him that if I were to answer the question, is that true? I will answer it philosophically. I will say yes and no. Yes, because the day I gave my life to Jesus Christ, I received power. Power of adoption. But no, because having been adopted, I need to grow. If I refuse to grow, I will become spiritually challenged child of God in the family of God. I know he appreciated my explanation. I said we needed to make a distinction between relationship and fellowship. Many people only come to fellowship without having any relationship with God. But if truly you are born again, on the day you are born again, this is the power that brings you into the family of God. It is called the power of adoption. The third type of power. You have underlined how many types of power? The first one, may be power of darkness, power of juju. That power, they very real. But they limited. Because that power cannot work all the time. That power, they fail. That's why it is called yeye. But this other power, now the power that brings us into God's family. We become member of God's family. God now become our papa. If any trouble burst now, he will stand for us, not for our enemies. He's our papa. Now this power will be so. But there's the third type of power. Luke chapter 24. My brother, read verse 49. Luke 24, 49, that's the second text that we read in addition to this one.
And behold,
behold,
I send the promise of my Father upon you.
Yes.
But tarry ye in the city of Jerusalem.
Yes.
Until ye be endued with power from on high.
Underline power again. What power is this? From on high. What power? You see, you are talking about the location of the power. You are not telling me the type of power. The power that comes from on high. Yes, we know that one. What kind of power it is? God's power. Holy Spirit power. You try. But for us to really understand, this is the kind of power you are about to receive. The moment I finish my own job, you see, I receive instruction that I should not come to your midst tonight. So you don't think that I'm the one distributing the power. I'm not going to come close to you, Rara. Me, I will stay here and see what the Holy Spirit is about to do. And he's going to do you good tonight. Yeah. He will empower you from tonight.
Amen.
Witches and wizards will see you and run.
Amen.
Medicine man will run.
Amen.
Juju people, they will fall before you.
Amen.
That's the power you need. With this power, automatically you don't need any cult, you don't need any theosophical society, you don't need any juju. You will be above, not beneath. Get ready. So this power in Luke chapter 24, what type of power is it? For you to be able to understand, you see, Greek is a wonderful language. Like most of African languages, you know, there are beauties in our languages. The African language is more beautiful than European language. Africans, we have identity. Oyinbo man no get identity. That is why they bear stone and gone. There was somebody in the seminary, his name was Gone. Another one was Maggie. But in Africa, we have identity. So, in the same way, our languages are so beautiful. I don't like for our people not to know their languages. Just like Greek language, African languages have beauty. You see, in Greek, a single word can have different meaning. This is not a matter of ambiguity. You know, when you say something is ambiguous, with clarity, in the same way, the Greek language, they can say the same thing, but with different meaning. For example, in John chapter 1, verse 12, where we talk about power of adoption, the Greek word that is used there is not the same as the Greek word that is used in Luke chapter 24, but both of them are power. In John chapter 1, verse 12, the Greek word is exousia. And what does exousia mean? Exousia simply means authority. So if I would write John 1:12 just like the Greek word says, I would say as many as believed him are given the authority to become children of God. Another word for authority is right. Some of you will have Bible where they put right. It's correct. As many as believed him are given the right to become children of God. Why must we be given the right or authority? Our Father never gave birth to us in the presence of God. God wanted us to be his children. Therefore, because Jesus died, because he was buried, because he rose again, God said, okay, because of what this man has done, I give you the right. You can now be my child. I give you the authority. You can now be my child. But listen, there is a big difference between authority and ability. In Luke chapter 24, the very Greek word that Jesus Christ used was dunamis or dynamo. What does that mean? That simply means ability. Now let me ask you, from what you have learned thus far, what will you say was wrong with the travelers on the way to Emmaus? Was it authority that they didn't have? Answer me now. The believers who were running on the way to Emmaus in Luke chapter 24, was it authority that they did not have? Answer now. Didn't they have the right of sonship? They had. Okay, what now in your own understanding did they lack? Ability. Ability to trust. They have authority of sonship, but they lack ability to depend. By the grace of God, if God wills, maybe I will be talking about, if we have the time, I might talk to you about the power of trust. These travelers never had the ability to trust God. They had the right of sonship. They had authority, but they didn't have ability. Let me illustrate with something that you will understand. In this our Nigeria, there are so many governors who have authority of governorship without ability because of the Godfather system. Is that true? He's voted for as governor, but he cannot act without going back to the Godfather. Is that correct? That is happening in my own area. He says, he's been a governor, make a command now. He cannot command, go meet that papa, that person, that juju man. That's the kind of thing. Many of you are children of God. When you confess him as Lord and Savior, he gave you the right to become members of God's family, but you lack the ability to perform. When trouble comes, you run back to the source because you do not have the ability to stand. So the very Greek word that Jesus Christ used means ability. You will receive ability tonight.
Amen.
I said you will receive ability tonight.
Amen.
I'm about closing. The only thing remaining is for me to tell you what to do. This ability is the power you want to receive now.
Amen.
But to make it clearer to you, do you know that the word that Jesus Christ used that we call dunamis or dynamo is the root for the English word dynamite? Do we have engineers here? Do we have engineers? Maybe mechanical, maybe electrical, preferably electrical. Raise up your hand. Don't be ashamed now. Please come, my brother. Please come. God bless you. Now listen to me. Everybody listen very well. Listen very well. I want you to listen to me very well. You are welcome. You will preach to these people now from your professional viewpoint. I told you that Luke never went to seminary. He was a medical doctor by profession, yet he gave us Luke. He gave us Acts of the Apostle. You are an engineer, is that correct? As an engineer, you can preach the message based on your own profession. Before he does that, let me explain one thing to you now. Listen to me very well. You can sit on my chair first. Sit down there. Let me give you order now. Clap for him. Now, so somebody they get promotion now. In the name of Jesus, you will be promoted.